Today on the IoT Show, we have Manoj from the Azure Data Explorer team, who is telling us about how to use and why using ADX in the context of an IoT solution. You're watching the IoT Show. I'm Olivier, your host. Today with Manoj, we will talk about Azure Data Explorer. Manoj, thanks for joining us on the show today.
Thank you for having me here.
Awesome. So Azure Data Explorer, you will tell me a bit more about what it is, but first, before we jump in there, who are you and what are you doing in the Azure Data Explorer team?
Sure. So I'm a PM in the Azure Data Explorer team. I'm here today to give you an overview of Azure Data Explorer in more in IoT context, and how customers can take advantage of the technology to build rich IoT analytics solutions around it.
Love it. So we have plenty of solutions in the cloud to do analytics, and they are specialized for a certain type of analytics. In that case, we'll dive into how you can do this rich analytics on the IoT data from devices.
Sure.
Tell me more about the principles of Azure Data Explorer and what this PaaS service offers.
Sure. So it's an interactive analytical service for fast-flowing data. So it helps customers to cut down their time to insights by integrating with those streaming sources like IoT Hub, Event Hub, Kafka, and bring data pretty quickly in just really large data in a really short time, as well as provide a rich interactive query where customers can query billions of records just in seconds, and so on, and build rich analytics on top of it. The service is also fully managed, so customers don't have to worry about index maintenance and auto scale. It supports auto scaling, so as the workload grows, it can auto scale. Customers, it's very flexible to switch, adopt according to your workload, and customers can switch between computes when they need it. And we have pretty rich interactive language that helps them to do advanced time series analysis and do other kind of analytics on top of our platform.
Tell me about the type of patterns that Data Explorer is used into your you're talking to us about IoT Hub, Event Hub, like streams of data. In that diagram that you have here, you're showing us this kind of patterns. Tell us a bit more about that.
Yeah, sure. So, it fits in an overall real-time analytics pattern where you have data coming in and you'd use Azure Stream Analysis for doing continuous streaming analysis, enrich your data as the data is flowing in, and use Azure Data Explorer for doing more ad hoc and on-demand analysis on a really large-scale data. And you persist this based on your business needs and so on. And then we have a rich set of integration with other big data services that helps you to read the data, integrate with other big data systems, and build rich analytical solutions.
Okay, awesome. As an IoT guy, I'm going to ask you, what are the use cases? When do I need to use or when should I use Azure Data Explorer?
That's next slide. So Azure Data Explorer is optimized for querying over structured data like time series, unstructured data like text data, semi-structured data like JSON and XML. So today we're just going to focus on IoT use cases. Mostly in IoT use cases, we have come across time series data, and a lot of customers have JSON data that they want to bring
That's
in.
Common indeed,
and in some scenarios where they have the sensor data, plus they also bring in some telemetry data from controllers and so on, and kind of merge them together and do rich analytics. So typical use cases would be, customers building their own IoT analytical solutions where they need full control on their data sources, data schema, data management, and analyze time series and telemetry data using our built-in capabilities. And I'll show you some of this in our demos, as well as, we have built-in machine learning capabilities and integration with big data systems like, Spark and Data Lake and so on. That makes it really powerful. And also our business model is more around, based on the compute that customers is using, and they can also take advantage of reserve compute. So it's very suitable for really large workloads where they can get pretty good discounts when they go with the reserve
basically
instances.
The cost is adapted to the amount of compute they're going to use, basically, thanks to Data Explorer. Got it.
It's amount of compute, it's amount of data, and so on. It's a combination of a couple of things.
Which in IoT scenario can grow really fast.
Sure, yeah.
Totally.
Yeah. And you know, customers building multi-tenant SaaS solutions where mm-hmm. they have their own ingestion pipelines, they have their own visualization layer, and they're looking for a data platform where they can host data and then query in a really low latency. So those are like common scenarios where we have customers going across using us for other scenarios as well. But this is in the IoT IoT context. Yeah.
And in this kind of use cases, we need to pound on the notion of platform and not turnkey, but platform solution, because we are basically implementing all the plumbing for them to focus on their value add, which is these algorithms to extract the insights and the insight that they're going to do and take action with, right?
Yeah. So pretty much we have like connectors to all the relevant technologies, which helps customers to build this solution pretty quickly, rapidly, as well as with a very low maintenance.
Okay.
So let me show you some demos.
Yes, please.
We're
here for that.
Yeah. Okay. So in order to get started, customers will have to get provision a cluster on Azure DataX, provision a cluster in portal.
Okay.
Create a database and ingest their data, so they can they can use our SDKs and APIs to backfill. Many customers have historical data sitting in blob storage or data lake they want to bring in, and connect the real-time sources like IoT Hub, Event Hub.
Okay.
So we provide those deep built-in integration. Mm-hmm. Like in here, this is my demo cluster where I have a bunch of databases.
Okay.
And customers can easily configure the ingestion pipeline here and connect to their choice of system and then bring the data in easily. So assuming my cluster is created, my database is created, and I've started ingesting data, I'll show how customers can do rich analytics. And for this demo, I'm using our web UI, but this is one of the experience that customer can use for doing ad hoc analysis.
Okay.
But the other experiences like integration with Grafana, Power BI, Notebook, if we have SDKs, APIs, REST APIs, and so on, that customers can use to get data out.
Nice.
So this particular data set is NYTexi data set, which is about 1.5 billion rows.
That's it.
very small data set. This contains trip information for customers taking yellow and green taxi in New York City.
Mm-hmm.
And it has information about pickup and drop location and how much fare was there and how much tip they paid and so on.
Okay.
So we'll do some analytics on this.
Okay.
Again, I'm just showing you a subset of the capabilities. The capabilities are pretty large.
Yep.
So the first one is, when you have this data, you want to do a quick analysis on the data. So in the first query, by the way, I'm using our web UI, and this, the way you start querying is, type the table name and then start writing your queries. And and the IntelliSense in our tools kind of guides the user to, with the right column to select, right syntax to select, and so on. So very rich, powerful query language. It's called KQL.
Nice.
And so in this case, I'm querying my table called trips, which is about 1.5 billion rows. Mm-hmm. And I'm filtering for a specific time frame and creating a time series data set and then rendering as a time chart.
Nice.
So these render commands are very handy to do a quick analysis right in the Explorer itself.
Nice.
So here we can see there is a certain trend. There are peaks and spikes and dips and so on. Then there's a trend. So let's say I'm running this business. I want to understand what's going in my business. Mm-hmm. It's a very rich thing here. Now, as a human eye, we can see that there are peaks and dips here. But let's say I want to do an automation and detect it through automation.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say it could be a sensor reading or something which is going anomaly and so on. So detecting anomaly is pretty easy.
Yeah.
So I'm using a similar query that I just ran, but just extending that query by calling this additional operator called series decompose anomaly, and we'll just send that same data through that function.
Okay,
and here we detected those anomalies.
Nice.
And I can tweak those anomalies based on certain thresholds,
mm-hmm.
and then build alerting and automation around it to go take action. So all this is built in. Customers don't have to take data out of the system, and also it supports single time series as well as multiple time series.
Mm-hmm.
For example, let's say you have certain device in a certain location, room, building, and so on.
Yep.
So you could just extend this query to say, anomaly by room, by location,
nice.
And so on. So nice. You can do multi-dimension
queries.
Queries.
Yep.
The next one is, customers can do regression analysis as part of the system. Again, we're just using the built-in capabilities here.
Okay.
Now here, We saw there was a trend, and then it spiked and suddenly started declining.
Yep.
So this kind of jump, you can detect this with this operator, where the suddenly something changed and mm-hmm. and the values changed. So this was a regression. This is a two fit line. We also have one fit line, which just shows you a linear relation.
Okay. Each time it's one line in the query.
Yeah.
That's actually super.
It's
well
just extending yeah. slightly.
Yep.
Now we understand there is a decline in the invert XE, right? And this decline started around 2014. Any guess on what would happen that time?
Yes. No.
No. Okay.
What happened?
So this private app based rights started coming up during that time.
Do we say your name? No.
Yeah. So we want to see what those private app-based rights are mm-hmm. causing, what's the impact of this, and then do an overlay of that. So for that, I have another data set called FHV trips, which is about 500 million rows.
Okay.
So now I'm running a query here, which will union the data from these two tables, run these aggregates on this 1.5 mm-hmm. billion rows, 500 million rows, and then we'll see a trend on what's happening here.
Okay.
So while this is we are filtering data for a time frame, mm-hmm. then doing creating aggregations, and then creating those aggregations in a 7-day buckets of window.
It.
So now we see it started declining, but at the same
fast.
Time
that was pretty fast though. We didn't cut that. It's all live.
Just 6 seconds.
Okay, so now you're aggregating the two and showing them on the same chart, and we see the growth. On one side and the decline
on the other side. So this is pretty powerful. In IoT use cases, you may want to see this one sensor started declining, mm-hmm. what happened to the other sensors, what happened to
you
get
data
some data
context,
from telemetry
basically.
And so on. So you can do that comparison here.
That's pretty solid.
So all these queries are just running within seconds.
Mm-hmm.
And lastly, now we found that they're growing pretty fast. Like you can do time series forecasting. Again, that's built in.
Okay.
Where we're going to go and forecast for next 28 days and see what's happening.
How
there.
Much trouble is
it's going to cause
the company?
Yeah. So that's like within 2.6 seconds. Mm-hmm. Gan went through, aggregated that data, created a forecast model for us, and now this is the. This is my original data, and then this is my forecasted data.
Yes, and you see the trend continuing.
It's trend continues month over month and so on.
Okay.
So I just showed you some of the built-in capabilities to do time series analysis. There are also other ML algorithms that helps customers to kind of auto-cluster within mm-hmm. the platform.
Yeah.
And if these capabilities are not enough, mm-hmm. We understand that machine learning and this area is pretty huge. We also have a Python plugin where customers can create their custom UDF. Mm-hmm. So in this case, this is another data set, but I've created a custom UDF mm-hmm. and embedded my Python code.
Yeah.
And I can just call that custom UDF in my query. So in this case, this is trying to detect occupancy based on certain values, mm-hmm. but this is running Python code.
Yep.
So this is my custom UDF, which I've defined here, which has Python code in it. And I'll just run that. And this is running on the same nodes where the data is. So it's very fast.
Mm-hmm.
And it can also take advantage of the distributed nature of the platform.
Nice.
So this actually, we got the data, sent it to the Python engine, and got the results out. So
So
this is very useful in kind of extending the capabilities if the existing capabilities are not enough.
Love it.
The final thing I want to show you is there are scenarios where customers, so in this case, customers have to bring data into Azure Data Explorer.
Mm-hmm.
So it is cached on SSDs. That's why the queries run really fast.
Yeah, yeah.
We saw that within billions of records, just a few seconds. But there are scenarios where customers have some historical data sitting in data lake.
Yeah.
And they would like to go and query that.
Yeah.
So we have a concept called external tables
mm-hmm.
through which customers can define an external table, point it to a blob storage or data lake, and then just query with the same language.
Mm-hmm.
So as a user, you don't have to switch tools and you're just changing the table name. So in this case, we're going to go and query external table, taxi rights.
Okay.
And just let's run this query. This is actually going and seeing how many count of cab types for the specific time frame.
Yeah.
And this particular query actually went to the data lake, got the data, and then got this aggregates.
Nice.
So those are the ones. So we looked at, you know, all the, you know, rich, powerful capabilities that we have, and I definitely encourage customers to go through the documentation.
Yeah.
We have a lot of content here.
Okay.
As well as one final thing is very attractive to especially IoT customers mm-hmm. is the integration with Grafana. So we have a built-in connector for Grafana that helps you to write queries and go and connect to your database and do build some rich visualization on top of it. So the one that I'm showing you right now is actually pulling in data from one of our demo data set called GitHub. And we have been populating this data live by querying, by calling public GitHub APIs.
Okay.
And getting public you know repo information yeah, and yeah. then just trying to get it as fast as we can. So you can see you know the data has been refreshed like 2 seconds, 10 seconds latency. So mm-hmm. latency pretty low,
yeah.
and we are seeing this in real time.
Nice.
And these are all built in. So let's go and look at some query. So I showed you some IntelliSense capabilities. All those are available in Grafana itself. So when you type queries here, you can actually, you'll see the same IntelliSense capability built in into Grafana.
Yep, pretty straightforward.
Okay, so yeah, in the short time, that's what I wanted to show you today.
Yeah.
We have more to cover, but you know, we'll have more sessions around other
topics. That's great, Manoj. So do you want to bring back the slide where you have the resources link so we can actually invite our audience to go learn more? So we have links here for the product page, for the documentation. We're going to add them in the description. And if you want to get faster onto the documentation, you can go to aka.ms/IoTshow/ADXDocs. So that's going to be your short link for getting into the docs. And then you have these tech community as well, where you can engage in conversation, get in touch with the product team that's going to be answering down there if you have questions. Manoj, great insight into Azure Data Explorer that I didn't know much about. So
thank you for having me here.
Thanks, guys, for watching the IoT Show. Hope to see you soon. Don't forget to subscribe.